Aloha.
Yeah, aloha is for tourists. You should say, how's it? Nobody? Yeah. How's it? Yeah, because when you guys go to Hawaii and then you surf in Waianae, did you guys go to Nanakuri? Yeah, those are the places that I never go even when I was living there. But I'm so glad that those of you who have gone to this mission trip, you have gone there and you have shown Jesus' love to the community. That, you know, I was kind of scared when I was young to go up to that area. But Jesus' love is what we have, you know, in our life that changes us, you know. I would never thought that I would, you know, go to places that I now, you know, go and serve, you know, like in the recovery ministry, the people that I normally will have a judgment on in my mind. That now I'm serving those people, you know. So God have changed our lives. If you are a Christian, your life should be changed from this old way into a new way. So today we're gonna talk about a new life in Jesus Christ, and it's a new and living way, or a role or a path. That's what the original Greek stands for. This way is like a path that we're going to be going on to. And we're going to continue in Hebrews in chapter 10, verse 19 to 23. So when I went, normally I don't watch a lot of movies, cartoon movies. But my wife told me to go watch this movie. Actually, I watched it when it first came out 10 years ago. And this is a second one, Inside Out 2. And, normally when I watch, like, even, you know, cartoons from Hawaii, you know, like Lilo and Stitch or Moana and stuff, I fall asleep, like, after, like, maybe the first 15 minutes. But this is, it catch my eyes, it catch my attention, because it's very real. I don't know if you have watched it, but it's you should go watch it. It's very real, and a lot of people can, you know, contest to it that this is happening to us. What is happening in this movie is that the emotion inside of us have this kind of like a control panel of controlling what we do as a person, and it affects us. The people who is outside affects our emotion. And different emotions take over and control us to do things. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad, right? And, those people, it's like in the movie, it's about a little girl. So those people is the friends, the teammate, the coach, the parents, people that she interacts with changes the way that she acts. And everybody is just like, whoa, what a good movie it is. And the only thing my son points out, who is a psychologist major, the only thing he said is, there's something wrong with this movie. It's like, in the end, the girl have handled her emotion quickly, like that. It's done. We don't normally be able to fix ourselves within ourselves. Like that, you know, it's like, oh, now I'm a good person again, right? It's not. And of course, he wants a lot of business, so, you know, he don't want you to be fixed so fast. You gotta come into different sessions so he can make money, right? You know, it's but I think there's something that in that movie that is, we change a lot. That nobody talks about, the movie didn't talk about, and that is super real. And especially for our as Christians, when we come to Christ, this movie don't talks about sin. It does not talk about our sin, the sinful nature of a person. Why does all this anxiety, when the anxiety emotion goes wild and the person goes wild, is because of our sins. I'm not saying having anxiety is sinful. But it's because of sinful nature, the way that we act out of our emotion is sinful. And there's bad things that come. And believe me, if this cartoon character is a real human being, she is continually going to be having all these kind of episodes all the time. And there's no solution. You know, in a movie, it might trick you into knowing that, thinking that there's a solution, but there's no solution. So even as Christians, we need to think about our sins. If we don't think about our sins, guess what? We don't think about salvation. If you don't think about your sin, you will not put a heavy emphasis on your salvation. And you will not have this relationship with God. And this is what in the Bible it tells us. In Romans, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. A lot of Christians, I'm sorry if I offend you, but a lot of Christians, when we come to Christ, we are thinking about going to heaven. And we don't think about our sins anymore. We need to think about our sins because we need to think about Jesus Christ so that we can have a relationship with Him. And our old way, we're still living in our old way, and the old way is a way that leads to death. Right? So, sorry. Is it working? Our old way, we live in sin. That's the old way. And if you don't think about that, you will always be living in sin. Romans says that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We are all sinners. No questions asked. We are all sinners. And if that offends you, I'm sorry. But we are all sinners. And our new life is our sin is forgiven. This is what I want to talk about, what I want to talk to you about. It's not that, you know, it's not that you go on this new life that is something that is a hassle. But it's a new life. It's a lively, you know, lively sin is forgiven life, a free life. And a lot of times when we don't think about sin, we don't think that we are in bondage. We are not set free. We don't even think about it. We are being hooked on our nose and follow the sin in a chain, but we don't even notice it if you don't think about your sin. And so 1 Corinthians 6:11, it says that, and some of you used to be like this, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. So if you think about sin, you will think about this verse, that you are set free. You are sanctified. You are justified. And today I want to, you know, to come together with you to think about sin and think about this new way, this living way or living path that we have in Jesus Christ. Let us bow our head. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us into this sanctuary of yours to worship you, to praise you, to be with you. And we thank you for Pastor Caleb to set an example that put you in our priority. I know that he's anxious to see his son laughing out loud, and he will. And we know that you will bring him safely home today and enjoy his family. And we ask you to open all of our hearts so that we think about our sins and we think about our new life that our sins have forgiven and how to live this life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today's Bible verse is in Hebrews chapter 10, 19 to 23. Let's read it. Therefore, brothers, since we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, He has opened for us through the curtain that is his flesh. I don't know why this is not working for me today. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in a full assurance of faith, a heart sprinkled free from an evil conscience, and our body washed in pure water. Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Let's take a look at this. It says that because of Jesus Christ, because of he dying on the cross, and it's talking about that his flesh, you know, this the Hebrew writer is thinking that his flesh is the torn veil that opens up our way into God, the holies of holy, which normally the Israelites, they go in, the high priest can go in only once a year to see the glory of God one time in once a year. And that Jesus' flesh on the cross have ripped open, and he's thinking that this curtain, this veil that opened up for us to enter in to see the glory of God. Imagine that. You have this privilege because of your sin is forgiven because of Jesus Christ, that you have a privilege to go and seek the holy God. I don't know if that enters your mind. It's like it blows my mind that you know, I'm sure you guys are not as bad as I am. But, you know, when you know that you are a sinner, if you're thinking about your sin and that Jesus has forgiven you, it blows your mind. If you start thinking about it, it just blows your mind. You can go to Wanai. You can go to Nanakuli. You can love those people. This morning, Pastor Jackie was sharing that this guy that, you know, the missionary that, you know, he was gunpoint, almost died when he was in South Africa. And he went back after he graduated to be a missionary. And you can love that. That's a scary way to live. But that is the new way, the new path. There's nothing to be afraid of, you know? So how do we get into this way instead of the way that is leading to death? Now, how can we enter into this new and living way? Is that we need to, you hear it all the time, and it's conversion. When you convert, right? When you become a Christian. But it's more than just accept Jesus Christ with your, you know, confess, you know, Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and receive it in your heart. You have to actually convert. Actually, you're walking in this path. Now you walk in this path. Don't accept Jesus and still walking in the same path that you were before in your old life. You need to convert into the new way of living. And it says that, you know, it says in verse 19, it says that, therefore, brother, since we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus, we have boldness now that we are not afraid. The chain has broken, you know. And there's a lot of times when we have accepted Jesus, but we don't, you know, we don't come to church, right? It's like, you know, there's other things that is more important than church, right? Like seeing your son and your wife, you know, and there's maybe you don't want to, you know, maybe you don't want to come to praise. You want to come late, you know. You just want to listen to the message, or maybe you just want to sing praise and then you leave, right? I don't know, but there's a lot of times like we pick and choose, but we don't put that priority, that relationship we have with Jesus. It's a new relationship that we enter into. And this relationship is a trusting relationship. I don't know if how much you guys trust Jesus, But the trusting relationship, if you trust him, you get all his promises in the Bible. In Hebrews 4:16, it says that, therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness so that we might receive mercy, find grace, and have help when we need it in the proper time. And it brings me to think about the Old Testament, about the Danites. The Danites, I don't have pointers here. Huh? So the Danites, this is on the bottom here. This is where their inheritance is. This is what God promised them and given to them, right? Right? And but they don't want it. They went all the way around. They went through Ephraim and come all the way up there to a small town that they can conquer. The reason why, because, you know, they live by the coast. One of the big cities is Joppa, and the Philistine was there. And they're scared. They don't want to be fighting all the time. So they went all the way up to the top, and then they conquered that part of it, probably a small city. And they call it Dan. A lot of times it's that when we accept Jesus, we have all this promise, all these things that God has given to us. And we say, no, thank you. I'd rather live the way I am right now. I'll just wait till my day when I die, I go to heaven. You know, no, thank you. I'll take the easy route, right? And so what happened is when they go up to that high country they conquered, they start building a sanctuary for God, Yahweh, right? They took a priest with them up to the country to be the priest. And then later on, this place of worship, because they went so far away from Judah, Jerusalem, the temple. So they went all the way up there. They want to worship God the way they want to worship God. And you know what? In the Bible, it talks about all these high places that the revivals that they have in Josiah and stuff, that they want to knock down all the high places. These are the high places that were, you know, when Jeroboam built a golden calf. This is the high places. That originally they think it's going to be worshiping Jehovah. Now it's worshiping other gods. Don't be led away. But hold on to the promise of God. And this is what Caleb came in as different. This is what he said. He said, now give me the hill country of the Lord have promised me. He's like 80-some years old. And he said, give me the hill country the Lord promised me on that day. And there's like giants there, he said. There's like fortified cities there, but no worries. I know God promised me this. He's going to break down these walls for me, you know. He take the hard way to grab a hold of the promise of God. Brothers and sisters, hold on to God's promise. It's the new and living way or path that he has provided for us. Other than a trusting relationship, we start to have a close relationship with God. So this close relationship is through the blood of Jesus Christ, through his flesh being ripped open, and that before we have a very offish kind of relationship with God. We cannot get there because of sin, but because of Jesus Christ dying on the cross, sin is forgiven, and that there is a way, a new and living way for us to get to God. When you have this close relationship, when you draw near to God, then true worship comes, and you have a true worship relationship with God. A true worship is not that, oh, I love this song, you know. A true worship is that the praise leader start to sing and the words start to move, the Holy Spirit start to inspire, and that you start to be drawn near to God and close to God. And that is the way that we should be worshiping God, to move us inside of our hearts. Remember Hebrews 4:16. To draw near, to be bold, to draw near to the throne of grace. And that we experience the grace of God, and that is priceless. So in order in all this progression of getting drawing near, drawing close to God, and relying on God's help and so forth, then we need to have a new heart. This new way brings a new heart. So this new heart, well, how do we get a new heart from God? A new heart is a new relationship with God. Now you can pray to God. Don't look down on singing praises and worshiping, but don't look down on praying either, because that is a privilege in itself that you can freely communicate with God. And that's how you get a new heart, is that in Psalm 51:10 it says that God create a new heart for me and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Because you pray for a new heart. You don't, no, I want to, like the movie in Inside Out. No, I am a good person. I'm a good person, And then you become a good person. No, you pray that, God, change me, oh Lord. Change my heart, In the movie Joy, the character, the main character, Joy, how do you get joy in the movie? It's that all the bad things, she go and put it in this machine, and it throws the bad memories, the bad experience, it goes to the back of our mind. That's what we do, don't we? We just, oh, forget it, but it sneaks back in. It sneaks back out. But in Celebrate Recovery, the recovery ministry that I do, you don't have to come to Celebrate Recovery to do this, because it's God who's doing it. The way that we do it is that we do an inventory of all the bad experience and the good. We balance it. And the good stuff, we praise the Lord. Praise the Lord that I have this. Praise the Lord that I have Makai, Praise the Lord, before that was, praise the Lord, I have a Tesla, right? But the bad things we bring to God together, we have a support group. Why are you in youth group? Why are you in church? Because we are a support system. You don't have to come to my recovery ministry to have a support system. That's why we are called a church. That we are here to support each other, to bring our bad things. If you guys can be honest, the one thing that in recovery ministry is priceless is that we got each other's back. We are very honest in our group. Sometimes too honest. Sometimes I cringe when they talk about stuff. But I know, just like you guys going to Wainai, Wainai is I think it's changing, but. Because a little bit down the road is Ko'olina, right? It's a Disney resort, right? I think it's getting better. But you need to pray for a clean heart. And why do we need to have a clean heart, right? We pray for a clean heart is because we see God more clearly with a clean heart. It says so in Matthew 5:8. It says the pure in heart are blessed. Why? Because they see God. They will see God. If you have a clean heart, you'll see God more clearly in your mind. And how do we do that? Okay, let's look at a new worldview. Now we have a conversion into a new worldview. What is your priority in life, right? We need to have a new priority in life, right? PS5? Did you say PS5? Oh, yeah. What's that? Not dying. Okay. That's a well, you have everlasting life, right? In church, in Christ. It's like a new priority in life is that you no longer think about all the, you know, of course it's important, you know, otherwise your parents will probably come and talk to me. You know, your education is important. You know, you are going to a good college is important. I'm not saying it's not important. Don't tell your parents that I say it's not important. It's important. But those things, in this new world view, in this new priority of life, you know, Makai is important. It's the new priority in life is very extremely important. What does that mean? This is what it says in the Bible in Luke 6:20-26. Well, we're going to look at 23 first. 20-23 first. It says that if you are poor, you are blessed. If you are hungry, you are blessed. If people hate you, you are blessed. If people exclude you, you are blessed. If people insult you, you are blessed. If people slander your name, you are blessed. You rejoice in that day. I don't know. A lot of people have a lot of problem with this Bible verses. They like the Matthew Beatitude better than the Luke Beatitude. But it's telling us, it's not telling us that you need to sell everything that you have. You need to sell your car. You need to, you know, get rid of everything. But it's telling you that when we have this desperation, the gift of desperation in our heart, we have this clean heart to see God. We are able to see God more clearly because there's nothing else. There's nothing in my pocket. You know, there's no more money. There's nothing else. I have nothing to rely on anymore. Only God. That is what it's talking about. It's not to tell you to become poor, to become hungry. No, I'm okay today. You know, I'm not going to be eating, you know. There's a time for you to fast, to honor God, to pray. But it's not that, you know, it's telling you that when everything is stripped away, we should have a mentality, a new worldview, that the priority is God, right? And it says that I have heard of you, rumors of you, but now my eyes have seen you. This is Job. A lot of times our pastors will talk about suffering when we read about Job. How come God allows suffering in our lives and so forth, and we try to make sense of it and stuff like that. I think it's very simple. For me, it's very simple. He lost all his family. You know, of course, it's not simple for him, but the message is simple. He lost all his family. His wife cursed him. He have no health. His friends ridicule him. He have nothing left. He have nothing left. And then he asked God, why are you doing this to me? And sometimes it's like this. It's not that God have helped us to go through a difficulty. Your situation might never change. Might not ever change your situation. But God is saying, I will be with you, right? Yesterday I sang, in my recovery ministry, I sang the song that said, there's another in the fire. And that's, you know, they still have to go, the three friends still have to go into the fiery furnace. You know, of course they were safe, you know, and God protected him. But it might not, God might not protect, but he is always going to be there for us. Keep our eyes on Jesus. That's what it's talking about. It's to whatever life that you have, I'm not telling you to be poor. I'm not telling you to go hungry. I'm telling you to keep your eye on Jesus. so that your new priority becomes a new self-worth. Now, you know, hey, I drive a Tesla too. Yeah, I'm just like Pastor Caleb. I'm not that poor, you know. I'm pretty okay. Of course, I don't drive a Porsche, but I'm okay, you know. But that's not my self-worth anymore. It's the self-worth is that God, Jesus Christ, had died on the cross and ripped open his flesh so that we can see the glory of God in our life. That is my self-worth, that God loves me. Of course, I want my parents to love me when I was young. Of course, I want my friends to like me. You know, of course, I fought so that people think that I'm like, you know, somebody that is important. But my self-worth changed when I came to Christ, because I know that I am my Father's son, the Holy Father, you know. But we have a lot of pride in us, don't we? Right? We have so in the second part of Luke, it says that woe to you that are rich, woe to you who are full, woe to you when all people speak good of you. We have a lot of, you know, even as pastors, you know, we are not immune to this pride. I have this Shower of Blessing USA made a video for me. And see, it's not coming up. Okay. Right? So when, you know, it's in Cantonese. So when it came out, never, you know, when I post something, usually I have like 10 likes or 10 views or something. But this has 19,000 views. Right? And then I said, so my pride get into my head, right? It's like every day I go in and kind of take a look when it's gonna be 20,000, right? Every day I kind of look, and then when I preparing this message, I realize that is my pride. You know, maybe one day Pastor Caleb is gonna be a pastor of a mega church, and then when I go visit and I say, who are you? Right? Say, I don't know you, right? No, I'm just kidding. He's very humble. But that's what it happens. When we get so high up in our stature, this is what it's talking about. Woe to you when all people speak well of you. It's not because, you know, that should be celebrated, but it might pull you away from our Heavenly Father, pull you away from your your salvation, because now you think you can do it, and that's the opposite of what we just saw in Luke earlier. That when we are poor, it's the same message. That we need to keep our eye on Jesus. And Jesus is enough. Okay? So I'll end with this. Verse 23. Other than conversion, we need to have conviction. We need to hold on to our faith. Let us hold on. 23. Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. Don't worry that sometime we go astray. Don't worry that, you know, there's a lot of things that happens in our lives and that it will affect our emotions. We hold on to God, and Jesus is our help anytime, right? Jesus is our hope anytime. In CR, other than we doing an inventory of what our past is, our good and the bad, we do a daily inventory. And it's the same thing for you guys. You don't have to come to Celebrate Recovery to do that. That is called a devotion. But you write your own devotion. You don't just do somebody else's devotion. You read a Bible verse, and you pray, and you ask God, what do you want me to do today? And then you go out and do it. And at night, you write your own devotion. Oh, God told me to do this. I didn't do it. I'm so sorry, God. Or God, you know, God, I did this. Whoa, I experienced you today. You told me to love my neighbor. I went over, and then guess what? He was my old classmate, and we hit it off, you know. And you need to have a relationship with God every single day in a daily inventory or a devotion. And this is what happens when, with our emotions. Instead of our emotions driving us, we get angry, we fear, we're scared, we're sad, we are joyful. It's that God is in control of the control panel of us. And everything we do is, this is what the Bible tells us, right? We need to be a witness of God. People need to see Jesus when they see you, right? And that's what we strive for. That's what we want to do. I don't know if we can do it. Sometimes we fail. It's okay. God has all the grace for us. But we try every single day. So if you do a devotion every single day the way that I'm telling you, you will see God in your life. I guarantee it. You will see God in your life. Let's bow our head. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are the Almighty God. You are the Sovereign God, and you do whatever you want to do. And we are just sinners in your grace. And Heavenly Father, we ask you to just help us to get into this promise that you have for us, a new and living way for us to follow every single day, and that it blesses our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.